Hi, this is Kalyan Karmakar, and welcome to yet another episode of Foodocracy for Her. Foodocracy for Her is where I speak to women entrepreneurs in the food and beverage industry across India, sitting at home in Mumbai, but thanks to Zoom and so on, one's able to connect. And today I've got to you a very special young friend of mine who's joining in from Mangalore with an M. And the first time I met her was in Mangalore 2 or 3 years back. And then again in Mumbai when she was doing some work here. We've been, of course, connected since then. And even when not connected, I've been very keenly observing all the fantastic work which she is doing. So welcome on board, Shia. Great to have you on. This is Shia
Shetty over here. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. It's an honor to be on your show.
it's my pleasure that in the middle of starting something new, and we're going to talk about that, that you could take the time out. You know, I find something very interesting about Shia's story. Now, for those of you who are familiar with Mumbai, you might know that Mumbai's restaurant industry was largely set up, at least the second wave. The original wave was 150 years back by the Iranis who came from Iran. But then in the 1960s, it was people from the Shetty community from Mangalore who came to Mumbai. And then they started setting up their restaurants, the vegetarian ones, the ODPs, the lunch homes, and so on. And they could be considered to be the ones who set the foundation or the bedrock of modern Mumbai's restaurant industry. And here you have Shia, who's a Mumbai girl, who's now gone to Mangalore for about 5 years back. And she's setting up her own little food thing, which is now really blossoming. And while I said little, I'm sure it's on its way to becoming an empire, but right now, she'll make it to many 30 under 30 lists perhaps, but Foodocracy for Her is not about the lists, it's more about the stories. So great to have you on board, Shia. And so tell us a bit Thank about you. That first, that tell us a bit about your growing up years in Mumbai, and where did this love for food come into you? Because that wasn't your chosen profession at the start.
Yes. So I think food has always been in my family's blood. I mean, we love to eat more than anything. And the way you said that Shetty's came and set up, the second wave of restaurants in Mumbai. But I have to tell you this, that, I always joke with my family that we are the black sheep of the Shetty families because we don't own a single restaurant. So nobody in my family, immediate family owned a restaurant. Not my parents or anybody of that sort. And I was the first one to kind of get into mainstream food industry, since the beginning. And it's always been about food for me. I mean, we used to look forward to our Sundays at home. We used to cook together as a family all the time. Snack time in the evenings were always very interesting. Like one day you'd have sepuri, you'd have dabeli, or vada pav. So we were completely Mumbaikars. I still am a Mumbaikar. I think I tell people, unless and until I've not lived in Mangalore for 21 years, that's how long I lived in Bombay. I'm not a person from Mangalore. I'm still a Bombayite staying in Mangalore. Bombay. Yeah, I did my entire education there, and I just moved to Mangalore when I was 22, I think. And it was mainly because when I started working in the industry, I figured out that, our cuisine is very underrepresented. And Indian cuisine as a whole is not something that can be done by one person, because there's so much of diversity. We've got, so many states, so many regions, and a single person doing it is impossible. So I thought, why not do something that I can, I mean, I've grown up being a Shetty, living in a Shetty household, eating food. And I was like, I may be able to understand that better than me trying to do, say, Italian or French or, any other kind of a cuisine. Like you said, I don't belong to the industry in the educational point of view because I'm a BCom graduate. And I did my BCom. And while doing that, I realized that, maybe I want to get into the food industry, but I didn't want to do it through the hotel management route because back then you had to do hotel management. You couldn't choose only culinary arts as your specialization. And I knew that was one thing I was very sure of, is that I only want to be part of the kitchen. I don't want to be part of anything else. And going abroad at that point was out of the question. It was way too expensive. Scholarships were not very easy to get. back then. So I was like, okay, let me try and see what I can do living in Bombay. So I started doing internships in different restaurants. And that's how I made my way into the industry, you know. So I started working at the lowest level and then kind of started moving my way up by gaining practical experience.
Yeah, that's a very interesting way and of looking at it. And I must point out to people that when Shia's talking of back then, that back then is not too many years back, because sometimes we've also spoken to people in food advocacy for who've been in the industry for a few decades, and they're like, you know, well-known stalwarts, and when they talk of back then, some of they're talking of the 80s and 90s like I do, but Shia's back then is like seven years back. It's not that, but I was smiling when you spoke about that 21 years in Bangalore bit, because that's how I used to calculate it, because I was born in England, then we lived in Iran, then we moved to Calcutta when I was about 8 or 9 years old, and then I moved to Mumbai in around 97-98 when once I started working. And I would also say that I am a Calcuttan and not a Mumbaiker, because I spent more years of my life in Kolkata than in Mumbai. Then at one point, suddenly I didn't know when, but one day I did the math and I said that, hey, it's been more years in Mumbai than in Kolkata. So yeah, maybe it's a Mumbaiker. So how did you find that route of, you know, not going to culinary school or hotel management, but straight away going and working with restaurants in Mumbai? And then I also know that you'd gone abroad and worked for a bit with some of the prominent Indian restaurants in Thailand and stuff like that. So what do you feel, looking back, was the pros and cons of that route, which you took? It's like not doing an MBA or something like that and going straight away into setting up or working with people who set up businesses to learn how to sell. So what were the pros and cons?
So I'll tell you one thing. One of the main turning points for me where I realized that maybe, you know, this is something that I'm interested in, is when I was 16, I did a cupcake making workshop. I attended a cupcake making workshop and I really fell in love with the entire process. And I had gone to this culinary studio where they had, you know, all the professional equipment. And I was really enamored by that whole thing. I was like, you know, this is something that is so interesting. I don't mind spending the whole day here and then coming back here every day. And once I started making cakes, I started baking at home and, you know, slow and steady started taking orders, because one person was like, you know, I want cupcakes for my son. So can you just take a paid order? And until then, I had really not thought about this as, something that I would do professionally. But I was like, okay, I may get some pocket money out of it. Maybe I'll be able to eat at a nice restaurant at some point in college. So I'll do it for the extra earnings more than anything else.
In Calcutta, we would give tuitions.
So in 11th standard, I gave tuitions as well. You know, so I used to earn, I think, 1,500 rupees. I gave for one year and then I got bored of it. And then I was like, okay, fine, let's get into this. So I started doing, I started taking orders at home and all of that. And then I started realizing that, you know, maybe I want to get more into this. But like I told you, hotel management was something, I don't know how, but I knew it since the beginning that I didn't want to go through the entire hotel management route. I was desperately looking for culinary courses that were there, but they were either way too expensive or they were not in India. So, you know, neither of them worked for me at that point, because I had just finished my 12th standard and I couldn't really pick that up. But in college, I had a friend whose father owned a hotel in Bombay itself, in Andheri. And he told me that, okay, if you're so interested, why don't you do an internship, you know, at my hotel and see whether you're interested. Do it in the bakery and see. And that's when I did my internship for a month. I used to go every day. And I realized that, you know, this is something that I absolutely love. And I'm not kidding you, Kalyan. 90% of that internship, I was only cleaning. Like, I wasn't doing anything. I was just the chefs.
So that is either real, cleaning. Huh? That is real. Yes. Like when chefs say in the beginning, we only clean or cut onions. So that is real. Not.
Of course. I was not allowed to touch the main ingredients. I was not allowed. I was allowed to just weigh out a few things that were the most basic things that they knew that I couldn't mess. They would make me clean the shelves every day. I had to clean the fridges every day. But I loved it. It was something that I absolutely loved because I got to be around the people at least, you know. And at that point, I was like, okay, this is, if I don't mind doing this, maybe, you know, it's, I do belong to this industry in some way or the other. And we had gone into a short holiday, and answering your question of how I realized that I should do my way through internships rather than, you know, study for it. We had gone to Alibag for a short family vacation, and one of the owners of the homestay that we were staying in was a CIA graduate. And I started talking to him about, you know, how I really like, enjoy cooking, and, you know, I want to do something. And he told me, he's like, you know what, instead of spending all your money and taking up loans and, you know, going to college and then spending the rest of your life repaying it, you just earn, you know, try and save up enough money where you can go and stay in New York or anywhere abroad, wherever there's a good food scene for 2 months. Stay in the tiniest of apartments, stay in, you know, a hole in the wall place. Just knock on the kitchen door and tell them, I'll work for you for free. Please give me a job. I'll do the dishwashing. I'll do whatever so that you get. And that's when it got me thinking. I was like, okay, maybe I can try that exact technique in India, because going abroad as an 18-year-old was out of the question, because my mom was like, "Auntie, don't finish your graduation. You're not going anywhere." I was like, okay, fine. But, you know, that was the seed that was put in my head that, you know, I can do this. He's yes. like, because he put out really good points. He's like, it's free labor. They don't really lose anything because they're not paying you, but you gain everything, because if you really work well, you will learn a lot out of it. Plus, you're not paying anything to, you know, gain the experience. And frankly speaking, the hotel industry, it is only practical experiences that help you. The kitchen especially, you need your practical experience. How much ever books you read, whatever theory you do, doesn't matter, because it's completely poles apart. Like you said, right? People think it's a very fancy thing about being a chef, but half the time we are only cleaning. 80% of our job is cleaning up. So it's always like that.
Yeah, you know, I've gone to Singapore to a place called Tippling Point or Tippling Bars or something like that. A molecular gastronomy place, and really fancy stuff. And I was sitting at the counter because Singapore Tourism had sort of hosted me there, and there were all these goras doing all the fancy stuff and smoke and mirrors a few years back when that was trendy. And then at the end, suddenly they removed those things and all, and started doing the jhadu pocha. Now, coming from an Indian context, you can't think of like a top chef who'd been doing all the fancy stuff suddenly starting jhadu pocha. Now, for people who are watching, and not everyone might know this, unless you're, of course, a Bowdoin fan. The CIA is the Culinary Institute of America. We interviewed Kishi Arora, for example, who's from there. So it's not the other CIA. So she was not going down the Carrie Mathison and Homeland route. Do you feel you missed out on anything by not doing a course or something maybe you might want to supplement?
Very, very honestly, I think other than one internship that I couldn't get because I didn't have an educational background, I don't regret the route that I've taken at all. The only part where I regretted it a little bit was because I couldn't get my internship into NOMA. I had applied for NOMA, and I had fought with them saying that, you know, how can you all value education over passion and practical experience. Yes. And then they had finally written a letter back saying that we are not judging you on it. The government will not give you a working visa if you don't have an educational background. So if you're not from the hot, you know, if you don't have a hospitality degree, you can't get an internship into NOMA because you won't get your visa. And at that point, I was like, shit, if I had studied. But then other than that, frankly, Kalyan, I think I have learned everything and way more practically working. And I actually did a 3-month hobby course in Dadar Catering.
Yes. Baking one? That baking course?
Yeah, the
one. I have friends.
It's got a very funny name. It's the Housewives Baking Course. That's what it's
housewives?
Called.
Housewives? Told me that.
Housewives Baking.
It's a co-ed thing, right?
Yeah, of course. But because it's a hobby class, I don't know why they named it, who came up with that. It was called the Housewives Baking Course. I thought, okay, we do a 3-month thing because it was only baking. And at that point, I was only interested in baking. I wasn't exposed to the hot kitchen at all. And I did that. It was a 3-month course. And out of those 3 months, I may have attended only 1 month, you know, because I just couldn't deal with theory. I wanted to be in the kitchen and, you know, do stuff. And I just couldn't sit and study. Like, you will see there are like a billion books behind me, which I can read. But if someone is teaching me, I want them to teach me practically, you know, because I can read with a book. I don't need someone to read out of a book and teach me, you know. Yeah. So,
which is a bit ironical, because at some point during the lockdown, you were doing teaching courses yourself, where you were conducting workshops. But I'm sure that you took a lot of stuff which you used to miss and made sure that you didn't do that, right, as a teacher.
So what I did was, and you, if I mean, for anybody who's attended my class, half the time I used to be like, you know, I don't know why I'm teaching you all this, because food is practical. But because of the lockdown, I'm trying my best to kind of convey the whole thing. You know, the, and we actually did a session known as a how to bake and how to cook. So instead of teaching recipes, we only taught theories, the science behind it, you know, because the science, you really need to have the formulae. And so our notes used to be very, very detailed. Flavor profiles and everything, and maybe two recipes in the end. So that's how we kind of modified it to suit people, because I can't be telling everyone that, you know, you have to be practical when you cook, but teach, you know, do online classes and expect people to kind of learn cooking that way. And a lot of our courses were bake alongs as well. So like, you bake along with me, so you make your mistakes.
Yes.
Even if it's through a screen, I'll be able to at least rectify it to a certain extent.
So people would have to keep the ingredients and all that ready before the class. You would tell them.
Yes.
Okay. That's interesting.
Some of the ingredients, we'll keep it ready and we'll make it.
I thought it was very nice of the Noma folks to sort of get back to you and say all this, because they're like the number one restaurant and everyone wants to intern there. So I thought it was very nice that to get back to, I mean, an unknown person and from India or whatever. I thought that it speaks a lot about their bigness.
I completely agree, because it's, I think you can learn a little bit of humility from those people, because I wasn't very kind. I was a very angry teenager at that point. And I was like, you're being so unfair. And just because someone doesn't have education, you can't, you know, I have passion. I've been working. That was after my Gagan stint. Like, I've got into Gagan and I've worked here. Yeah. I will work for free. I will do my own place. And then, you know, they're very sweet. I was just like, okay, for the next 2 weeks, I was like, fine, no problem. I understand. You know, because so, if it was me, I wouldn't have bothered replying to a person like that.
No,
like,
I'm
very honest.
No, and they're so big. I mean, they are like, exactly. One, like the top. Yeah. Now, since you mentioned, you know, Gagan, the thing, but just anything before we move on about the various internships which you did in Mumbai and abroad. Mm-hmm. Any experience which you felt really made a difference to your career, or something really big which you learned, either in terms of skill or which you feel has helped make who you are today? Like any person, any experience, any incident? Would love to hear that.
I think every single place that I worked in, you know, has kind of helped me, has helped shape me into the person that I am today, professionally and personally as well, because the kitchen teaches you a lot, and it teaches you a lot about life. It teaches you how to prioritize. It teaches you to be clean. It teaches you so many things, right? And I think I started my first internship, proper internship, with Chef Kelvin Chung at Ellipsis. And I had written to him again the same way. I just used to email a lot of people. Nobody ever replied. Chef Kelvin was the only reply that I got, and I grabbed that opportunity with both my hands.
He comes across as a very warm and friendly person. I've interacted with him occasionally because of the circuit, but he comes across
With him, I actually wrote an email for 2 weeks. I sent him 15 emails in 2 weeks.
Oh my God. He didn't put a stay order on
it. I was really annoying. Like, if I need something, I will just make sure that I get it regardless of anything. So I kept emailing him, saying that, Chef, you know, I don't have any background in this, but I will work for free. I will work as a dishwasher if you want. Just give me a space in your kitchen. And, you know, every day it used to be one new thing that I would do. You know, just, I would be a hole in the wall. I'll be a fly on the wall. Don't worry about me. And if you don't like me, you kick me out. I'm not going to stay or anything of that sort. And, you know, after 2 weeks, I got a reply saying that, hey, I'm so sorry, I've been busy for the past 2 weeks and that's why I couldn't reply to you. Can you come meet me, you know, 2 weeks from now or something, one of the dates. And in January, it was January 2014, I think. And I was like, okay, let me go. And I went there with like this entire resume filled with whatever home baking I had done and whatever reviews I had got.
And that's how our initial review, initial resumes are always like that. Captain of the school, pottery class, you know, section
8A. So a couple of articles had come out and a couple of reviews had come out. So I went taking all of that. He saw none of it. And the only question he asked me is like, why do you want to do this? Like, do you know what you're getting yourself into? And I was like, yes, chef, I know. And he's like, are you crazy? I was like, no, I'm not. But maybe I am, but I want to kind of get into this. So he was like, okay, fine. When can you join? And I was a little taken aback because I was like, doesn't he want to ask me any more questions about my skill or anything? He's like, you're joining as an intern. So yeah, when do you want to join? And I was in my final year at that time, and my board exams were in March. TY BCom boards were in March, and it was January. And I was like, I can join next week. And he was like, don't you have board exams? I said, I'll not give exams if you want, because I was scared that he'll say you can't do the internship if you can't join immediately.
And it's and like a dream job and a, you know, very well regarded chef.
So I mean, I obviously spoke out of the top of my hat and without thinking, because later on when I went out, I was like, thank God he didn't say yes, because my mother would have killed me. I went home and said, I've done 5 years and now I'm not giving final exams. So he was like, you're nothing doing, you're going to finish your exams and then you're going to join. As soon as you get your exam dates, you let me know. You can join whenever you want after that. And I said, okay, no problem. As soon as my exam dates came out, I didn't call anybody. I just sent an email to him saying that my exams end on 12th April. I'm joining you on 14th April. And everyone was like, don't you want to go on a vacation? You're done with education and you know your boards. And I said, no, I want to join. I want to really, really see what this industry is all about. And when I went to Ellipsis, I started off in the bakery, obviously, because that's when, I mean, at that point, I thought that that was my only interest. And there
a bit of a stereotype, right? For women, patisserie.
Yes,
I mean, that's always changing, but that was the always stereotype earlier. And the reality also. Yeah.
Yeah. So that is something I noticed in every place that I joined. Like, they would first ask, oh, you're a pastry chef. And I was like, no, you know, later on, I used to be like, so they would, whenever I went in, they would be like, okay, are you, you know, interested in history? And I was like, I mean, with Ellipsis, yes, because that's all I knew at that point. But after that, I always wanted to get into the hot kitchen. And it was a very tough thing to, you know, kind of make that shift.
And also, Kelvin, apart from being a great chef, is also known for his dad. Dessert and confectionery. So that's the strength of Kelvin.
Yes.
So it makes sense to learn patisserie from someone like him.
So when I was in Ellipsis, Chef Hina was the pastry chef, who's the pastry chef now at Bombay Canteen and Obed Row. And she was the one who was heading the pastry department. And I mean, I learned all of my baking from her, like from scratch. Whatever I know, my pastry was from her. My bakery was from another chef who was there called Chef Imtiaz. And I mean, all of my other, you know, all the way you behave in a kitchen, whatever you learn from scratch is Chef Kelvin. You know, he taught me how you're supposed to be, how you're supposed to work. You know, my hot kitchen training, all of that happened at Ellipsis. And that's how I started off. So I started with pastry and then I fell in love with the hot kitchen at Ellipsis. And I was like, I want to stand in front of the fire. I don't want to be baking and doing all these delicate things because it's not me.
So you're saying that sort of Kelvin played a big role in terms of how you conduct yourself in the kitchen. I think that's, and that's so a great foundation in your first internship. You know,
yes, he taught me, I mean, everything, right? Because I didn't have any kind of training, no professional knowledge of any kind. And I think his cooking kind of set the base for my cooking as well, because he was a very freestyle cook. And at Ellipsis, we cooked with the ingredients that we found rather than define our menu by a cuisine. And I think that's a very interesting approach to food, because then it doesn't matter where in the world you are, you can always make sure that you are, you know, bringing out the best in every ingredient, because you're the ingredient first approach. And that's how, I mean, that was major part of my Ellipsis training. And post that, again, I dabbled with the thought of going to culinary school, and I actually applied for the International Culinary Center for an scholarship at that.
So you applied, you were having second thoughts, you said.
Yeah, I did think, I was like, okay, maybe I can apply for a scholarship. And so I was confident that I could go abroad, and I thought I'll do my education, which was only in culinary. And I would do internships on the side that maybe would kind of give me some sort of earnings to at least fend myself and, you know, kind of live through college. And it was about, I think, a 1-year course. And in Ellipsis, I fell in love with pasta. So I wanted to learn Italian food. And we used to make our own pastas there. I was like, I want to learn. So the course that I applied was for an Italian specialization course. And it was a 1-year course where 6 months you lived in New York and 6 months you lived in Italy. And I was like, there's nothing better than going to Italy and learning about Italian food, you know. So I managed getting a part scholarship. And at the same time, I had not stopped applying for internships to restaurants abroad that caught my fancy. And Gagan was one of them. And when I got my scholarship, at the same time, I got the offer to stage at Gagan. And, you know, so I was at a crossroads, like, do I do this or this? And I, you know, Chef Kelvin was my mentor at that point. So I went to him and I was like, I don't know what to do. I was done with Ellipsis. I was done. I worked there for 2 years. And I was like, you know, I want to learn more and I want to go abroad and stuff like that. So he was like, you know, you've always thrived in practical experiences. So if you've got another stage, you do that, you know, rather than going to school again and kind of. So that's how I decided, okay, let me go and get my stage done at Gagan. And that's how I landed up in Bangkok in 2015, I think.
So the mentor, like in this case, Kelvin, who sort of took it upon himself to guide you. It's lovely to have people like that in one's life.
Yes.
You had an interesting experience in Bangkok, I believe, in one of your assignments after Gagan. You're saying that was quite a learning experience. Which was that?
So I had 15 days left on my visa. And like an idiot, instead of roaming around and traveling through Thailand, I decided I'll work some more. And I got an internship at this place called Michaela's in Bangkok, who happened to be Chef Kelvin's friend, Chef Dan Bach, who used to work at Grace in Chicago. He was a sous chef, which was a three Michelin star restaurant. And he had just opened his own restaurant in Bangkok. And I asked Chef that whether he'll give me an internship. And you know, being Chef's friend, same thought process. He was like, yes, she can come for 2 weeks and, you know, whatever she wants to learn out of it. But I feel as an impact, Chef Dan's restaurant had the most impact on me as a chef, as a young chef growing, you know, getting into the career, because the way they worked, let me tell you, there were like 4 people in the kitchen. Chef Dan and his then girlfriend, now they've got married, you know, and Faye, they started the restaurant, but they used to be in the restaurant from morning till night. Faye used to take care of front of house. He used to take care of back of house, you know, the kitchen. There were 4 people. Everybody cleaned. There was no designated utility staff. There was one guy who would come to wash the vessels. But when he was not there, everyone used to take turns to go and wash vessels, including chef. You know, it was not just make your lower people work. And every single thing he taught us to treat the kitchen like we would, you know, work at home. Like you wouldn't throw kachra on the floor at home, right? You would take it in your hand and throw it in the dustbin. He's like, why can't you do it here? Just because someone is going to come and clean it, don't just throw it on the floor. You're going to take it and you're going to throw it in the dustbin. And there were 4 of them in the kitchen. The food was excellent because he taught me how you use an ingredient to the fullest. He was plating up a broccoli salad And the only ingredient in that salad was broccoli. So he had broccoli puree, he had broccoli stem that was, you know, just, he had ribbons that was cut out of it, he had deep fried broccoli, and it was one of the most balanced salads I have ever eaten. So, you know, it really teaches you a lot about how you can really utilize an ingredient without adding like hundreds of fancy things in it. And one of the best things that I liked about him was the fact that he always sent his staff to eat food before he went to eat. So at 12:30, you were forced to take a break, sit together, have your lunch, come back, and then he would leave every time before service. So you eat your food before service, then you feed your guest. You know, so all of these little things, I think, really matter in an industry which is very, very brutal to you.
Yes.
It is a very brutal industry for the people who work in it. I mean, everyone already knows that, apart from the ones who are outside the industry, and it's very easy for us. But it is a very brutal industry because you're working 16 hours. You're always on your feet. You spend time with your team more than you spend with your family. So it's extremely important to build a culture that, you know, operates like a family in the kitchen as well. That's the reason a well-equipped, you know, a well-oiled kitchen, you will always see that the people are always, they've always got your back. You know, you're very close to them. You know how to work. The longer you work, the better you get at it. You know, you need to have that rhythm. And when I had applied for a job, I was like, chef, you know, I really want to join Michaela's. If you have an opening, please let me know. I feel like one of my major criteria for hiring any new chef is that my existing staff should like them. So he's like, doesn't matter if I like you, you're not going to be around me very long because I'm running around all the time, but my team needs to like you and they like you. But the problem is Bangkok has a rule where if you hire one foreign employee, you need to hire four Thai. And at that point, he didn't have the strength. He's like, I can't afford hiring four Thai nationalities to hire just you, because he himself was a international employee. So because he's American, I'm Korean, but an American citizen, he's like, for me only, I don't have four Thai people working under me.
But even for 2 weeks, you were joining for 2 weeks, even for that.
No, so I finished my 2 week internship and then I got offered a job there. But because of these technicalities, I couldn't really join. But that is something that I still tell people. I was like, once my business is, if my business ever gets set up, I'm taking at least a 3 month break and just going and working at Michaela's again, because he's now gone ahead to open two more restaurants called Candice and Caper. And he has his own Michelin stars. So, I mean, he's one chef that I worked with him only for 15 days, but I think he had the most impact on me as the kind of chef I wanted to be. Like, I really look up to him.
But such people are really marvelous. And I feel that sometimes it's not the quantity of time which you spend with them, but even in the interaction which you've had, which could even be a one-off if that person's made such an impact on you. You're talking about setting up your business. So I want to go now on to that, because Foodocracy for Her is about businesses. And when you set it up, there'll be probably so many people who will come to work with you that you might not get the time to sort of, you know, work on your dream and working with chef over there. But tell me a bit about, like, you moved to Mangalore and then what happened? Like no one really knows anything about Mangalore. So
lots of things happened ever since I moved to Mangalore. So Varun and I, we moved to Mangalore about 5 years ago because I wanted to do research on Mangalorean food. And
which is your own home tradition. Is Varun also Mangalorean? Is Varun Mangalorean as well?
So, which is purely coincidental, but I mean, it worked for the best for us. And the two of us moved here and we were like, you know, we'll do research on Mangalorean food. We'll open a restaurant on the side, a really tiny restaurant that, you know, probably serve traditional food and stuff like that. But in a very modern setting. But I think we were there 5 years too early at that point. And luckily we realized that before we kind of did a brick and mortar place. So we decided to continue doing, and when I actually started doing research on Mangalorean food, I realized that there's so much more than just the Bundt community food that is there.
Yes.
Being a Bombay person, the bunt food is all you eat, you know, mostly. Yes. It's you hardly eat anything other than
the ghee roast and the curry roti and all of that, right?
Yeah. So, and here when you come here, you've got so many different communities and everybody's food is different. And I was like, this is not going to happen anytime soon. You know, I'm going to take a couple of years to even scratch the surface and get into it. But in the meanwhile, we had to have a source of income because you will know for sure, a lot of people who are doing research will know that research doesn't really pay you. You do it out of your own passion. You do it because you want to do it and not because someone is telling you to do it. And you always have to have a source of income on the side. And that's how Pupkins Mangalore happened at that point. I was like, you know, the city isn't ready for a restaurant, but they like their dessert. People will pay for good dessert because that is something that they don't really spend time cooking at home as well. And the breads in Mangalore were not Bombay breads at all. The breads here were sweet. And I think the bakery part of it was opened purely for our consumption because I couldn't deal. I'm a pav person and I couldn't deal with the fact that the pav here was meetha. So, you know, I was like, I'm baking for myself. If people want to buy, they'll buy. And then that's how we started selling bread as well.
Yeah, I remember time we met at that time, you were doing the dessert menu for a restaurant over there. And we met over some very intricate desserts which you've done.
So we did a dessert pop-up. And that was, I think, a year and a half after we started Pupkins. And you won't believe, Kalyan, until then, people used to assume that I am a home baker who bakes from home, who probably got married and came to Mangalore because I didn't have an option. And, you know, Shetty's, so they're like, husband must have been from here. And I was like, I'm not married. I'm a professional chef. And only when we did that pop-up at Diesel Cafe where you came and ate,
yes,
they're like, oh, you're a chef. I was like, you know, whenever you've asked me this, I've always told you I'm a chef. But just because I'm a girl, you always assumed I'm a home baker or not. And, you know, I do this as a side business for myself, but this is my profession. I'm like, oh, we didn't know that. Oh, you worked at Gagan. And I was like, excuse me. So, you
Gagan,
know,
ellipses, everything.
Yeah. And I was like, okay, no problem. And then it used to irk me a lot. But then I was like, just, you know, let me just do what I want to do and let me. Yeah, people will get to know whenever they...
even the idea behind Foodocracy for her is a bit of a humble attempt to just show that because, I mean, you know, people might say that, why are you focusing on women? Does this mean that women are not professionals? Is that whatever? But the fact of the matter is that a lot of people are not aware of, you know, the skill, the enterprise, the work over there. So it's just a humble attempt to just put these stories out so that people know, so that, you know, the next time when there's another Shia Shetty who maybe goes to Mangalore or something, then people will not think that she's coming here because she's got nothing else to do in life.
Yeah, exactly. No, you won't believe because when I moved from pastry to the hot kitchen also, the number of questions, the number of people that asked me this one particular question saying that, you know, with pastry, you can at least manage after you get married because you can bake cakes from home. But in the hot kitchen, how will you go to the restaurant after you're married and you have kids? And I was like, screw you. I'm doing what I want. You know, to put it in a very nice way and to be very polite. Half the time, I have to just smile at them and not answer because it used to boil my blood. And, you know, when people talk about...
I don't think people realize it when they make such comments. They don't realize what the person on the other side is thinking.
They don't realize it at all. And also, I mean, as recent as my Bombay Vintage pop-up, I had a very, very well-educated guest, very well-traveled guest who had come in. And, you know, they loved the food and him and his wife had come in. And
the food was lovely. I mean, I was there as well. Yeah.
Thank you so much. And he, you know, called me out and he wanted to ask about the food. And of course, it's a pop-up. I'm trying to talk about my culture. So I went out to talk to him and explain everything. He's like, okay, tell me a little bit about yourself. So what do you do? And you live in Mangalore. I was like, yes, I do. So he's like, so are you married? I was like, no, I'm not. He's like, yeah, no wonder you're doing all of this. And I was zapped at that point. I didn't know what to say. And I was like, what do you mean?
Shifts for marriage. Yeah.
Like after you get married, you're not going to have the time to, you know, do such pop-ups and come. I was like, excuse me, I'm a professional chef. and he put out a very like disgusting statement, like, yeah, but I don't think your husband or his family will allow you. And I was like, if my husband, I mean, if I have to take permission for my career, I'm not marrying that person. Please get to know this. And he realized that I was pissed, so he couldn't really take that forward, you know, the conversation. But I was like, well educated, well traveled, traveled the entire world, speaks great English, and yet, you know, you put such statements in front of me when you see a female chef serving food. And it is pretty pissing off, you know. It's reversed now. I mean, because you have a lot of great women coming into the hot kitchen and, you know, just owning up to the great skills that we have. But I'm not saying that it's completely gone. Like, even though people say, oh, thanks to social media, people know so much. But no, I think that basic thing about, you know, what you're going to do. Okay, now, okay, you're married, but once you have kids, what will you do? Like, I mean, who are you to decide, yaar, what do we want to do with life? So it's really, I'm glad you're doing this. Because even how clean, even though it's very cliche to, you know, right now, so many people try and just do women empowerment stuff to kind of seem very forward, but they don't really make any impact. You're actually talking to people on the field and hearing out their stories and just putting it out there. So, you know, it really does make a big difference.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's a bit of a function of the fact that I lost my dad when I was very young. So I was brought up by my mom. And then I'm married to someone who's a very successful professional in advertising. And I think that it's her support which allows me to go out and chase my dreams. So I think that maybe a bit of that. But Shia, tell me that when what do you do when this sort of rage comes over you? How do you react to it? Like, do you get angry, or do you withdraw into a shell, or how do you move ahead? How do you move ahead? How do you make sure that you're not put off the track? You know.
No, see, frankly speaking, how much ever I talk about, you know, this is the answer that I'm going to give the next time person asks me this question. And, you know, I'm going to reply like this. I don't give, you know, two shits about what they say. I'm going to stand up for myself. But the fact of the matter is that when they ask you that question, the first thing that hits my head is that, am I really standing in the year 2020? And now 2021, where people are asking me these questions, where, you know, that what are you going to do? And so I'm taken aback. And at that point, other than giving like maybe like a polite but stern answer, I can't really bring out my rage. But then after that, it really, really, really pisses me off. And, you know, I've tried to kind of just calm myself down. And I was like, I'm just going to show them now. I'm just going to prove them wrong. And, you know, this, just tell them that there's absolutely no difference between a girl and a guy. And I mean, you know, we can do whatever we want to. So as much as I feel like, you know, I wish I was angry and I would have yelled at this person, but it really doesn't happen when it actually, because you're shocked. It's mainly shock that takes over, that a person even has the audacity to ask you such a question. You know what I mean? So it's just surprise that, you know, people still think like that in today's day and age. And then I've got Instagram to take out my rage as well. So I'll be very polite. I'm like, yeah, okay, fine, whatever. And then I'll go to Instagram. There'll be like huge rant about it. So, and then I'll be like, okay, fine, done. I'm fine. But what I've realized about myself, I don't know if I can talk about others in this context, is that I love proving people wrong. So if somebody tells me I can't do this, I'll make sure that I do it. You know, so.
Once the Instagram post is done over with.
Even in the hot kitchen, when I wanted to go into it, I think one of the main reasons, apart from the fact that, you know, I really loved the way it felt and the way it was, but the number of people who told me I couldn't do it, I had to prove that I could do it. And I was like, no, now I am going to become a hot kitchen chef and I'll show you. You know, and I think that whole, I mean, I would like to feel that I kind of utilized that entire anger and rage into something good and made myself better out of it. But I don't know whether it really worked or not. So
no, but I just absolutely love that attitude of
Yes.
I think it's a great attitude that you took your rage and built on it, and I must. I was also going through your Instagram because you were talking about Instagram, and you put up this post where you said unpopular opinion, but I actually love 2020. So do you want to tell us a bit about what 2020, the year of Corona or COVID, yes, was for you, and what are you doing now?
So 2020 has been bittersweet for, I think, every single person on this planet, not just our country, but everybody, because it's changed us in so many ways, right? And I think being startup entrepreneurs, Varun and I never ever got a chance to kind of take a break, because when you're starting up a business, however small it is, what people don't realize it is that it takes up 24/7, 365 days of your life. And, even your days off are filled with work that you can't do on your working days. So it started off well, and I absolutely loved the lockdown because I got to spend time with family and, just enjoy, do things that I couldn't do, spend time with my dogs and, just relax for a bit. Also, being fully aware of the fact that I think I consider myself very lucky that nobody close to me was taken away due to COVID during this time, and that's the reason I can think about it like this. It's not me being insensitive about the fact that, forgetting the number of people who lost their life due to it, but
this being is just grateful for
yeah, this is just me being grateful for the fact that I got to do all of this. And I mean, I did have family members who got COVID, but they all recovered with it as well. And we also took, I remember the number of precautions we used to take, like wear a mask, and there used to be timings to go out and, go and get your groceries. We used to kind of see who's going and, what are we getting? Let's not make too many rounds and all of that. Yeah, so
we've all been through that. And like I said, I mean, this bureaucracy for her would not have happened if the pandemic hadn't happened. We'd all be going through our regular routines.
Right? Exactly. So it really allowed us to stop and take stock of what we've done in the past few years and, how we need to kind of improve and improvise on it. We were a little saddened because of the fact that we had opened Buttercream in December 2019. And it was 26th of December, which is basically the end. And you can consider that we opened it in January 2020. And in March, the lockdown happened. So 4 years of running Pumpkins, as an artisan bakery and as a cloud kitchen of sorts, and then putting up your first store and 2 months later shutting it for you don't know how long because, you didn't know what was happening with the world. And our store had to be shut for 6 months because it didn't make sense.
New store, you've just opened it.
Brand new store. We had put in our heart and soul into it. It was a very small space, but I can tell you that every single tile was chosen by me and Varun, and our friends helped us select and do up the place. It was literally done by hand, and we had to close it, and close it in the sense we had to temporarily shut it down. And it was shut for 6 months. We started Pumpkins again, say in around May or something, when, just as a, for some cake orders, but we knew for a fact that it wouldn't yield us any much, too much of revenue of anything. And that's how the workshop started.
Also. Yes, yes.
That's how the workshop started, because we had to have some source of income and we were like, people are interested in learning. So let's do workshops that are different and not. And there came a point where everyone was doing workshops. So that was also, I was like, why is every single person doing it, But then I was like, you can't really judge. People are making the most of what they have at this point. So you can't really be like, why are they doing? So we're like, let's do stuff that we are really good at and, people are very interested in. So we started taking workshops, and that's how I could really build my base. And that's how I could really talk a lot about Mangalorean cuisine. And
yeah, because Buttercream is confectionery. But in the workshop, a lot of it what you're doing was about Bangalorean food. And your page also is very interesting because your identity as a pastry chef is there, but there's so much you're talking about local food, traditional philosophies, even the utensils and the pan and whatnot.
Correct. So I think for the most part of the past 4 years, I used to hide the fact that I knew pastry as much as possible on social media, only because of the fact of how easy it is to box a female chef into being a pastry chef. You know, so that is something that I regret. I was like, why did I even hide it? I mean, I could have just told people that I know both and that's what I do. But I was like, if I talk a lot about my pastry work and all of that, people will start thinking that that's all I do and not really concentrate on my other side. I mean, it's only now after the lockdown that I've realized that, you know, why does a chef always have to be put into either a hot kitchen chef or a cold kitchen chef? They could be both if they are interested in it. So that's how I started talking about both simultaneously. Before that, it used to be more about my food and, you know, just traditional food and, you know, kind of using the platform to tell people about Mangalore and the work that we are doing.
I guess there's certain things which are apt for that time. And then with time, you, like, for example, I was seeing that post of yours also, where you said that this is the stage where this is going to be my last workshop, because now I need to focus on Buco India. And I think that that's also very important as an entrepreneur. And I also feel that myself as a freelancer, because you don't have other people to bounce off. I mean, at the most, our spouses, Varun in your case, kind of mine. You know, the same, because otherwise you feel like, okay, I've done this, and then we get too fixated to it, and then you don't know when to, because sometimes the situation changes. At one point, like even workshops, at one point it was all about live, but now even Pulukesi for her, it started as lives, but now I do recording because people will not switch on at any point. So tell me at the point when you decided to sort of stop the workshops and again get into Buco India. The short form of buttercup, and then buttercream. And what are you doing now? What are you guys doing now?
So during now, the reason why I love 2020, these are all the different, you know, reasons that allowed me to fall in love with that year that most people didn't. And I think during somewhere around August, July or August, we got a call from someone saying that, you know, we know that you're doing research on Mangalorean food. We know that you're looking at opening a restaurant, and we are doing something very interesting in Mangalore itself, and we would like you to be a part of it.
And you did not know them. You did not know them before this.
No, at that point I didn't. And
so they know, they knew of you and what you were doing, but at that point you had no idea these guys were seeing what you were doing.
Yeah, not at all. Amazing. And at that point, you won't believe this, Kalyan. I was like, I'm not interested. It was the middle of the pandemic. Okay, you need to understand, like I keep telling them, you need to understand my mindset at that point. It was the middle of the pandemic. So psyched. We didn't know what was happening. I was like, I'm not interested in opening any restaurant. And I kept the phone. It was a very sweet lady. And I just kept the phone. I'm like, I'm not opening any restaurant. And then she called me again. And she's like, no, maybe I didn't explain myself, you know, properly. But I would really like it if you and your partner could come and meet us. Like, absolutely no, you know, no compulsions on anything. Please just come and meet us. Have a look at what we are doing and see if you're interested with it. And because she was so persistent, I was like, you know what, Varun, let's just go and see. I don't know what's happening. Apparently there's a hotel coming up in Mangalore, and I don't know who's doing this, but let's go and you know, see what's happening. And when we went and we met them up, and you know, there's this beautiful idea. There's our partner now. I mean we know them very, very well. And our partner Prashant Arur and you know, his wife Pavitra, they were the ones who were calling us up, and they had decided to open up a post-pandemic hotel in Mangalore. And Prashant comes from the hospitality background. He ran Mango Hotels, you know, across the country, and he was the, you know, he used to run these hotels, and he's done a lot of work. For the past 10 years he was in Bombay. The pandemic brought him to Mangalore. He's a Mangalorean, but moved to Bombay because of work. And the pandemic brought him here, and he's like, I need to do something in my own city because it's a beautiful city. It's ready now for something
it's
new.
A lovely city.
And I think the pandemic has really given us that opportunity to kind of reinvent the hospitality industry. And I think that was one thing that Varun and I really, really liked, is the fact that there's not this person who was just trying to open a run-of-the-mill hotel here, but he was trying to reinvent it in a way where he was envisioning how people would travel post-pandemic, you know? So
that's true. I mean, we're all traveling within India, if at all. Yeah,
exactly. So he saw that and he was like, I am going to do that in my city. And, you know, the people of Mangalore are so well-traveled, but they don't have a lot to do here. And he's like, we need to make sure that we have something for the people in the city to come to as well. And so the Avatar Hotel, that's the reason it's called the Avatar, because it's in a new avatar and it's a new hotel that has been born out of this pandemic. And it's like this boutique lifestyle hotel that is coming up. And it's got three restaurants, so three eateries. One of them is Buttercream. And that's the coffee shop and the bakery and patisserie that we are running out of there. But it's got two restaurants. So a lot of people who've been behind us to kind of put a brick and mortar space. I think now officially, this is the first time I'm telling people that we're actually opening two restaurants in Mangalore as well. We are the F&B partners. Yeah, so Varun and I are the F&B partners of the entire project. And
Hot and cold.
Yes. Everything, hot, cold, veg, mixology. So, you know, we've got everything in it. We've got two restaurants. One is called Pickle and Green, which is a signature vegetarian restaurant. And the hero of the restaurant is rice. So what I realized during the pandemic...
The Bengali in me loves that.
So what we realized is the fact that India is a rice-eating country and Karnataka as well. But the types of rice that people know is limited to the number, you know, how many ever you can count
basmati,
on your finger.
Basmati.
But India has, Karnataka itself has around 3,000 varieties of heirloom rice. There used to be 50, 60,000, but now because of monoculture, it's all dying. And our idea is to kind of preserve that, conserve that, and talk to people about it. And rice
and
has got
like
a
in
very...
Karnataka, people think of millets nowadays. I didn't associate it with rice.
Yes. So rice, we've got some great varieties of rice that grow here. And when I say that the hero of my restaurant is going to be rice, I don't mean that I'm going to serve 100 types of biryani or pulao. It's about using rice in every form possible. You know, so we make beaten rice, we make the poha, the patla poha, the jada poha, we make rice flour out of it, which is used for frying. We make akki roti, which is basically rice bhakris, which can be used as tacos. You make desserts out of rice. So, you know, it's basically giving rice the importance that we always give it at home, but we always back talk about it, you know, when you're talking in public, because you think it's cooler, but it's really not, because we've got so many varieties and we want to really showcase those varieties. And it is a vegetarian restaurant, which is very challenging, because this is like a pet passion project for me. I want to make a vegetarian restaurant stand out, in Mangalore. And we are taking kind of the sustainable approach.
Yeah, because Mangalore is a city of fish and meat, and even for the Christians, the pork. And all of that.
So one of our restaurants is this Pickle and Grain, and we'll be making our own pickles and, you know, try and create as much as possible in-house itself and utilize the ingredient to the fullest, you know. So I think sustainability is in the core of the hotel brand as a whole. So I think moving forward with every single brand, any business that comes up, sustainability shouldn't really be an option, but it should be a necessity. You
put this picture where you've gone with a box to buy your vegetables, and you spoke about no plastic wherever possible.
I think sustainability, we've come to such a point where sustainability can't be optional. You know, you need to make sure that you are finding better ways to make, to cook, to reuse, and, you know, all of that. And the second restaurant that we have is called The Loft. which is a more fun, casual dining. It's got a great, it's going to have a great bar with some great drinks and, you know, a space where, you know, we can have local talent coming up and performing and all of that. And then Buttercream Co. is the bakery that there is. So there are three spaces. Super excited. And the way it changed our life is because Varun and I had actually, we were not sure whether we wanted to do a restaurant in Mangalore. You know, we were like, we'll do our research and we were like, okay, we'll figure out when to do it. But then at this point, we realized that if you partner up with people who kind of have the same vision as you do, you can really, you know, execute it, because we've ran a small business for the past 4 years. Now it's a full-fledged hotel. So, you know, it's got a very international approach, but built for the local market. So very, very excited about it. I'm going to have you come down to Mangalore again.
So you're living up to your Shetty genes now. Oh, yes. You're becoming a hotelier.
Now, I've taken out my family from the black sheep of the Shetty list.
I'm so happy myself, and your excitement is truly infectious, because I remember 3 years back going to Mangalore and we didn't know each other then. Then we caught up. And I met Varun and you. By the way, she's on Instagram as Chia Shetty. And Chia Shetty. Not Shetty, Chia Shetty. And then, you know, we met at Diesel Cafe. And then both of you took me to the local market and to that 100-year-old grocery store where you recommended that I buy different poris and papers and all that. And then I had a dinner invite at night. So you guys took me to a market where you said that, you know, to buy those flower bracelets, which would be the ideal gift. And then, of course, later in Bombay, when you did the pop-up at Bombay Vintage. But I knew the sort of dreams which both of you had. And sometimes, you know, one has these big dreams, but you never know, or you're wondering that how's that going to come to life? And suddenly, poof, out of nowhere, you've just been focusing on your work. And then you feel that no one's seeing it. And I know it can get very frustrating when you're by yourself, but there are people actually seeing it. And these amazing doors open. So even before you invite me, I'm going to book my ticket, because I love Mangalore and I'd love to go and have million types of pickles, million types of things made with rice and hang out with the local talent in the loft. And then maybe have some nice desserts when the doctor's not watching. Yeah. But thank you so much, Shia. I'm so happy for you and to Varun, and congratulations also. You guys got hitched last year, so
thank you.
Great to have you on board, and wish you all success in the future. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kalyan, for having me.
Thank you.